last, I'm sorry, last year, but there is also a colloquium lecture on
Thursday. Okay, yeah, but it's the last of the four lectures. And so let me remind you something that we did in the previous lecture. So we showed that on the positive Grassmannian, there is some nice decomposition into cells, into positroid cells. And these positroid cells are in bijection with decorated permutations. Decorated permutations, so which are just usual permutations of number 1 up to n with a little bit extra information. For any fixed point, for any element where pi of I equals to I, you color it in two colors. There are two types of fixed points. And the way how we did it, we constructed some graphs, some Plevy graphs that give parameterization of each cell. But for every cell, there are several Plevy graphs, and they're obtained from each other by some moves. And on the other hand, for each graph, you can define permutation, decorated permutation, that does not change, then you do these moves. So they uniquely, unique invariants of these completely characterize these equivalence classes. But also, I mentioned in the end that there is a more direct way to go from permutation to decomposition of the Grassmannian. And it works not only for the positive Grassmannian, but for Grassmannian over any field. So let me again remind you how to do that. We can define positroid stratification of Grassmannian GRKN, not only over R, but over any field F. And the way how to do it is if you take a matrix that represents a point in the Grassmannian, so and the matrix with columns V1 up to Vn, so these are vectors, column vectors, that's a point in Grassmannian Kn. So we can associate to this collection of vectors a permutation. So there is a decorated permutation, let me call it pi, which is defined as follows. It pi of I equals to j, it sends index I to index j, exactly when if j is the minimal, like in the cyclic order, so it's the first element, so it's the minimal index such that Vi belongs to a linear span of the vector following it. So it belongs to a linear span of Vi plus 1, Vi plus 2, and so on up to Vj. So you find the first index j, so that's true, and that means that pi of I goes to j. And for example, if vector Vi is 0, then you have a fixed point. But another option to get a fixed point, if Vi is a cos-zero, if it's the zero of the dual matroid, in other words, it does not belong to the linear span of everything else, so in this case, the minimal j, so to find this j, you need to make a full circle, go whole way around the around the circle, and in this case, and come back to the same index I. So again, if we have a cos-zero, we also get a fixed point. So, and we want to distinguish between these two types of fixed points. And we define a positroid stratum here as the set of all elements of a Grassmannian with given decorated permutation. So that works for any field. And so let me, just to make sure how it works, let me show you an example. For k equals to 3, so remember in this case, we can... Well, let me take some element in the positive Grassmannian, or in a non-negative Grassmannian. So let's assume just that our field is R, and remember that those elements can be described by n-gon, like by kind of degeneration of an n-gon. So you have n-gon, so you have these vectors arranged as the vertices on the plane as a vertices of the n-gon, but somehow you will look at all possible ways to degenerate it. So what, for example, one way is the following. So maybe that's vertex 1, maybe that's vertex 2. Maybe 1, 2, 3 happen to be on the same line. Maybe this is 4. And maybe 5, vertex V5 happen to be on top of V4. So we indicated by this kind of double point. So maybe the 6 is equal to 0. So and then we can, I think you right suggested to put it, draw it in the middle to indicate it as 0, and say this is V7. Okay, so that's one way to represent a cell in the positive Grassmannian. So it belongs to, in non-negative Grassmannian of rank 3, and we have 7 elements, GR 3, 7. Now let me show how to get the decorated permutation. So what's the decorated permutation here? That's the permutation of 7 letters, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So now what happens, so what is pi of 1? Okay, not exactly, well because, so let's see. So you take 1 and you see, can you express V1 as a linear combination of V2? Yeah, you cannot do that because they're not kind of parallel to each other. But V1 can be expressed as a linear combination of V2 and V3. So pi of 1 equals to 3. What is pi of 2? So is 2 a linear combination of just 3? No. If it's a linear combination of 3 and 4, no, because you can get only points on this vertical line. And 5 is also not enough, and 6 is not enough because it's 0. So it has to be 7. Now for 3, so you start 4, not enough, 5, not enough, 6, not enough. 7 is not enough because you only get this line. It's, and you have to go back cyclically, so it's equal to 1. So for 4, so what's pi of 4? It's 5 because these two vectors are collinear. What's pi of 5? So let's go 6, 7, 2. And 6 is 0, so it means that it's this fixed point. And for 7, you take 1, 2, 3, not enough, it should be 4. Okay? And you see that you get a permutation. So you get a permutation, and I think you asked last time, is it clear that it's a permutation? Is it clear? So should I leave it as an exercise or should I prove it? Because I thought I should prove at least one thing in this lecture, and I don't want to prove any hard things. I can prove only trivial things. So, let me just represent another. Tell you another way to represent the same permutation.
So you indicate that six is a zero. Or
yeah.
The decoration. How do we?
Okay. So how do we decorate? So there are going to be two types of fixed points. So let me show another way to represent this decorated permutation, which is kind of even more insightful. So you take right 6 points on the circle, 1, 2, 3, sorry, 1, 2, 3, which are not 6, but 7, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and I draw directed chords from 1 to 3, from 2 to 7, from 3 to 1, from 4 to 5, from 5 to 2, from 6 to 6. But how do I do it? So I'm going to draw this as a little counterclockwise loop. So counterclockwise loop indicates that this is a fixed point of the first type. It's a zero. If it were a cos-zero, I would draw it in a different direction. And finally, from 7, we have to go to 4. So we can represent this decorated permutation by this diagram. And let me give you another example, just to where we get two types of loops. So let me take this example. Let me do it like this. 1, 2, maybe 2 is 0, 3, 4, 5. Okay, so let me... So the permutation here would send, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1 goes to 3, 4, not enough, 5. 1 goes to 5. 2 goes to, 2 is a 0, it goes to 2, and it's kind of like white. I don't know, let me kind of put it in a white circle around it. 3 goes to, 3, 5. So where 3 goes, can you tell me? Right, so you see, so 4 is not enough, 5 is not enough, 1 is not enough. You have to go back to 3. So 3 goes to 3, that's another fixed point. And that's kind of fixed point of the other color. So that's kind of white fixed point, this is black fixed point. Then 5 is a linear combination, 4 is a linear combination of 5 and 1. 4 goes to 1. And 5 goes to 1, 2, 3, 4. So you get a permutation, and the diagram here will be like this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So 1 goes to 5, 2 goes to 2, and I'm going to draw counterclockwise loop. So I'm going to draw a loop like this. 3 is the other type of fixed points, so I'm going to put a clockwise loop. So there are like two types of fixed points, kind of little counterclockwise loops or clockwise loops. 4 goes to 1, and 5 goes to 4. Okay? And a little lemma, simple lemma, that actually if you do this construction, you always get a permutation. So you said it's obvious for you, or? Okay, so, yeah, I really like to, because I think I feel I should give you at least one proof. Because otherwise it would be totally, you know, groundless. I mean, so how? Yeah, that's true in general matroids. Yeah, that's actually true in general matroids. Oh, Okay, exercise. This is always a permutation, even for general matroids. Okay. So you can define this permutation for any matroid. You can actually define the kind of positroid envelope of matroid, in a sense. There is a kind of minimal positroid that contains this matroid. Okay, so for any matroid, you can define this decorated permutation, because all these concepts here, like linear dependence and so on, that can be done not only just for vectors, but just in matroid theoretic terms. Okay. Yes, right. So we say, instead of saying that linearly dependent, we say that it forms a, I think, linear dependent. Like in matroid, they also say dependent. Instead, you just drop word linear, just say dependent. Dependent subset of a matroid. Just kind of remove word linear, then you get exactly the same definition that works for matroids. Okay. The other thing is, so that means that, and claim is that this decorated permutation uniquely, so I in bijection if positroid cells. And now if you look at the decorated permutation, it's clear what's n. Like, that's like the number of points, but what is k? So how to figure out k just by looking at this diagram? So there is also a very simple combinatorial way to figure that out. Okay, so what is k? So let me define k of pi to be the number of indices I such that w of I, oh sorry, not w, pi, I think I used pi for the parameter, pi of I is less than I. Plus the number of black fixed points. So you count one type of fixed points, but don't count the other type of fixed points. And lemma is that actually this is k. Like, like if you have a cell, positive right cell, strong Grassmannian GRKN, then K is, okay, lemma, let me just write it, K equals to K of pi. Okay, so this is K that we have. So for example, let me do it in this example. So you count, look at this permutation, and count how many times you go down. So for example, here you don't go up, up, here go down. It's like, and and here also, and here, and here we have fixed point, which is white fixed point, you don't count it. So you see, you have, in this case, K equals to 3. Oh, okay, okay, well, K of pi, let me write, K of pi equals to 3. So claim is that K, yeah. And for example, in the last example, you would count, you go, like here, you count this guy, you count this guy, you count this guy, and you count this guy. So you have also three positions. And exercise, another exercise for you. I mean, should I give exercises? Because there is like, okay, so exercise that, simple combinatorial exercise is that for K equals to 3, you have these two combinatorial ways to describe the cells, first in terms of diagrams of this type, these kind of diagrams, right? That kind of degenerated and gone diagrams. And on the other hand, decorated permutation, if K of pi equals to 3, exercise, check that this is actually a bijection. So that's the, you can go from this diagram to this decorated permutation if K equals to 3, so that's actually one-to-one correspondence.
You have to make some notation for vectors in the opposite direction.
So what's the question again?
If you have two vectors in R3 in opposite direction, then how do you...
So if you have two vectors in opposite direction,
yes.
So then...
How do you denote them in this
diagram? Okay, so if you have two vectors in the opposite direction, I mean, they're still like they're proportional to each other.
Yes. So they
would be represented by a double point. Right. So for example, if you take, so when can we get two vectors in the opposite direction? So one and two cannot be in the opposite direction. If they are collinear, then actually they should be in the same direction. But like one and seven. Oh, actually, in this case, you cannot get, like for k equals to 2, you can get vectors in opposite direction, I think. So, for example, 1 and n, if they're proportional, then they should actually point in the opposite direction. But for k equals to 3, that's actually not allowed. So in these kind of diagrams, for k equals to 3, you will never get vectors in opposite directions. But for k equals to 4, for like even case, you can get vectors in the positive part of the Grassmannian which points in the opposite direction, but
if you extend this, you know, two-dimensional example by one vector sticking to the side.
You have
three. And
have to be careful. Yeah. Well. Yeah. I think I have to think about this. But like for k equals to 2, so you can get vector. So first of all, you can get two equal vectors. So for example, so we can get like v1, v2, v3, v4, and again v4.
So
that's in the non-negative Grassmannian. Now, if you do cyclic symmetry, if you put this guy in the front. And then you have to change its sign. For k equals to 2, you change the sign, so you get minus v4, blah, blah, blah. So you get first and last vector in the opposite direction. But for k equals to 3, then you do this cyclic shift, you don't change the sign. So now, if first and last vectors are parallel to each other, they actually go in the same direction. But in the next dimension, they can go... Oh, anyway, so... But as I said, so we can do this construction not only for the positive part, but for any collection of vectors. And then, yes, they can be in the opposite directions, but two vectors pointing in opposite directions kind of correspond to the same point. That's kind of a projective picture. Same double point indicates that two vectors are parallel to each other. Okay. So next thing is that, again, that's something that I mentioned in the last lecture, is that we can actually define free, well, not even in the first lecture, we have free subdivisions of the Grassmannian. Free natural subdivisions of the Grassmannian that now works free stratifications of Grassmannian Kn that actually work for any field F. So first is the Schubert decomposition. Then we have a refinement of this Schubert decomposition, this positroid decomposition. And then they have the kind of finest subdivision into matroid strata. Okay. Now let me define these free subdivisions in different terms. So we define them in terms of these decorated permutations and bases of matroids, but we can also define them in different terms. So again, let's take the collection of vectors that represent some point in the Grassmannian. So what's the matroid data? Oops. So what's the matroid data? What information about these vectors? What do we remember when we talk about matroids? We remember actually all ranks, so that ranks of all subsets of vectors VIs. Okay, so if for any subset of a vector, you know the dimension of the linear span of these vectors, like ranks of all subsets, you get the matroid. So that's, there are several axiomatization of matroids, one in terms of the basis, and then there is axiomatization in terms of these rank functions. There are some bunch of axioms that they should satisfy, and one can go from one to the other. So for example, if you know all ranks, then of course basis will be subsets of highest rank that contains exactly that many elements. And you can go from one to the other. That's kind of classical result on matroid theory. So now, what's the positroid data? That's also ranks of all, but not all subsets, but all consecutive intervals. All cyclic intervals. All cyclic intervals. So in other words, you need to remember, for any I and j, you need to know the dimension of the linear span of vi, vi plus 1, vi plus 2, and so on, up to vj. And again, you assume that indices are taken modulo n. So if for any I and j, you know this dimension, then this defines the positroid. And finally, what's the Schubert data? Should be even weaker information. So can anybody actually figure out what's the Schubert data? Like, is there a similar characterization of
just
Schubert?
The basis,
no? Huh?
Just the basis?
No. Basis? No. Basis is matroid data. So if you know the whole
dimension of the things that start from the right.
Exactly. So that's ranks of all initial interval. Can you read it? Initial intervals. Yeah, it's kind of a little bit crowded, so let me erase something. So to get a Schubert cell, So to get a Schubert cell, so Schubert. So you need to know ranks, let me call it Ri, which are dimensions of any initial interval. You start with V1, V2, and go up to Vi. So if you know all these ranks, then you know the Schubert cell. Now, remember that some theorem that I mentioned in the first lecture, that the matroid stratification is the common refinement on n factorial Schubert decomposition. So that's pretty obvious. What does it mean in this term? Suppose that you know all these ranks for any initial subsets, but with respect to all possible ways to arrange the i's. Then basically you get all subsets. The other effect, the other claim that I mentioned, that this positroid stratification is the common refinement of n Schubert decomposition with respect to only cyclic shifts, that's also obvious here, because if you know these initial ranks, but with respect to only cyclic shifts, so cyclic shifts of these guys are exactly all cyclic intervals. So that defines you the positroid data. And so that means that this, like, from this point of view, these theorems become very simple. Now, so the Schubert data, so these Ri are in these kind of possible ranks, are actually in bijection with Young diagrams. So first of all, so there are exactly n choose k possibilities for these Ri's, because these Ri's are not just arbitrary collection of numbers, they satisfy some conditions. So what's the condition? So we get like 0 less than or equal to R1, less than or equal to R2, and so on, less than or equal to Rn, which is equal to k. Ranks quickly increase, and they cannot increase too far. So if you go from Ri to Ri plus 1, this difference is less than or equal to 1. It's either 0 or 1. So you can jump only by one place, and it's easy exercise to check that there are exactly n choose k possibilities, and it's in bijection with Young diagram that fits into k by n minus k rectangle, and so on. So Schubert data is n choose k possibilities. N choose k possibilities for Schubert data. How about positroid data? So for positroids, we now we have these Rij's. There are also these Rij's are also not arbitrary collection of numbers. They also satisfy some conditions, and basically condition is that every time then you add one element to your interval, the ranks cannot jump more, but they quickly increase, but they cannot jump more than by one. Right? Again, like, so you have like Rij plus 1 minus Rij, and also Ri minus 1 j minus Rij. So these guys are equal to either 0 and 1. No. Yeah, right. So you kind of, then you increase interval, you can either add something on the right or add something on the left. That's the interval from I to J. Okay? So these two things. And of course, the ranks of the whole subset for all elements equals to K, and rank of empty is equal to 0.
With this constraint, wouldn't it be possible you have two segments, each of Rij 1, and the whole thing would be of Rij 3 or something like that? I mean, the union would be of much bigger Rij.
So if you take these things, like if you have disjoint union of two intervals,
yeah,
then of course the rank of the sum can be equal to sum of two ranks.
Yeah,
but it's less or equal than sum of two ranks.
But does it follow from this?
I think...
Yes.
Okay, exercise. So figure it out. Does it follow? But anyway, so every time then you add one element, you cannot jump more than by one. And claim is that this data, this collection of Rij satisfying these conditions, is in, like all allowed positroid data isn't bijection with decorated permutations. So we can go from these ranks to decorated permutations, and backward. So how to get a decorated, suppose you know all these strengths, how to get a decorated permutation? So, okay, did I erase it? Oh, yeah, no, I didn't erase it. So, right, so look at this. So what does it mean that pi of I equals to j? So what does it mean that vi belongs to a linear span of these guys? That means that if you take rank for this interval, and take the, from I plus 1 to j, and add one element, vi, take the rank from I to j, they should be equal. That exactly means that vi belongs to the linear span. So this equality, vi is in the linear space, is exactly then rij equals to ri plus 1j. Okay, and for any fixed I, you find the minimal j that satisfies this equality. So that means that if you know all these rij's, you can very easily figure out the permutations, and also you can go backward. So if you know the permutation, you can actually find all these ranks. So should I tell you, I'm going to tell you and the rule and leave it for you as an exercise to check. So, and actually let me give you the rule just by example. So where is the, okay. So where is the example? Okay. Oh, I think I raised the example that I needed. Okay, let me give you this example again. So how to figure out the rule. So, okay, so let me take this. How to go from ranks to pi, that's easy. Okay. Now let me tell you, give you a combinatorial way how to go backwards from pi to the ranks. So, by example, so we have this kind of diagram, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and the corresponding diagram pi is represented by this graph. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 1 goes to 3, 3 goes to 1, 2 goes to 7, 7 goes to 4, 4 goes to 5, 5 goes to 2, and 6 is a counterclockwise loop. Okay, so for example, so what is R13? You take points 1, 2, 3, and they span, well, they span a line, but actually it's this line represents a two-dimensional subspace in three-dimensional space, so this is equal to 2. Now, how do you see that in this diagram? So you look at the first three points, 1, 2, 3, and they look at the number of arrows that enter one of these points from a bigger number. Okay, so for example, there is arrow that enters 1 from 3, that's this arrow, and there is arrow that enters 2 from 5. So the number of such arrows is R13. So now let me tell you another example, R25 maybe. So what's R25? From a bigger number. It can, for example, this arrow enters from the same interval, but it enters from a bigger number. So
you showed us with the permutation, right? Where I goes to something smaller than
Exactly. Like, so for example, if you do it for the whole, like for all numbers, that's exactly this k of pi that I defined before, but we can get from this permutation not only k of pi, but also
formula that you gave us.
Yeah, that's generalization of the formula for the whole, rank of the whole, dimension of the whole collection of factors, but it's also true for any intervals, and like how to figure out for R25. So what's the R25? By looking at this diagram, so points, they span whole three-dimensional space, it's free. So how to get this number from the diagram? So what you need to do, you need to cut, like, so it's, this diagram is drawn on a circle, you need to cut it. You cut this circle right before 2. You need to cut it in this position. And if n unfolded, so if you do it, so you have points 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1. And the diagram, unfolded diagram, looks like this. So there is an arrow that enters 3 from 1. There's an arrow that enters, well, like this. 7, and here we have okay, now it's a little bit, now I not only unfold it, but I also flip it over. Now it's a little bit, so actually this counterclockwise loop becomes clockwise loop somehow, because I kind of, I cut it and I unfold it, but somehow in this picture I should actually draw it below the diagonal. But anyway, so if you do it, you get this kind of unfolded diagram. You look at the interval from 2 to 5. And again, you count the number of errors that...
There are a few errors missing, right?
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Right, so yeah, let's let me finish. So there is an error. So from... what is missing? 2 to 7.
And 3 to 1.
3 to 1. And is that... Yeah, I think that's all. 1 to 3, 3 to 1.
There's an error from 1 to 3.
And 3 to 1.
So 1 to 3 and 3 to 1. So yeah, I got these two arrows. Okay, so that's the unfolded diagram. And now I'm looking at this interval from 2 to 5. And I'm counting the number of arrows that enter one of these points from the right. So I would count this arrow. I would count this arrow and this one. Well, again, in this case, all of them go from outside of this interval. But I said before.
Inside.
All right, so inside. Yeah, we also count, we allow, yeah, right, yeah. Okay, so anyway, so the number of such arrows is the rank. So exercise for you to check that this is really a bijection. So this combinatorial rule gives you the rank function, and that's the bijection between allowed rank functions and decorated permutations. Okay. Yeah, right. Black ones, so you always... So, for example, you kind of think about this loop as going from the left to right. So it means that you don't count this loop. But for the other loop, you would count it. You count it going from right to left.
Okay.
Like one kind of loops are never counted. The other kinds of loops are always counted. Okay. Okay, the other thing that you can do in terms of these decorated permutations is you can describe the partial order on the cells. So you can describe partial order, how these cells are attached to each other. So what's the partial order? So suppose you have, we say one cell is less than or equal than the other cell if and only if you take the closures of these cells, the Zariski closures, one of them is contained in the other. That's the partial order. Well, maybe I should show by containment of Zariski closures. Exactly. It's one cell belongs to the boundary of the other cell. Natural partial order. Well, actually, maybe it's very easy to describe this partial order in terms of rank function, in terms of ranks. So can anybody figure out what does it mean in terms of ranks? That means that just all ranks should be less on, like, term-wise, weakly, like, all ranks for these cells should be less on equal than the corresponding ranks.
Less on equal?
Yeah, less on equal than the corresponding ranks here. So in terms of rank functions, so this partial order is very simple. But also we can describe this partial order in terms of decorated permutations. So let me describe the covering relations. And these covering relations, actually this partial order is very similar to what is called Brewer, strong Brewer order. So it's very similar to, it's kind of, I call it circular Brouwer. It's kind of circular, symmetric version of the Brouwer order. So let me try to describe it in terms of these diagrams. How one diagram, so what are the covariant relations? So covariant relations are the following. So suppose in this diagram you have two crossing chords. Okay, and crossing, and they're kind of minimally crossing. There is nothing else, like if you take this area between these, like sources of these chords and the interval between sinks of these chords, there are no other errors, no other arrows from A to B. There are no, so that's, I mean, yeah, okay. So in this case, what you can do, you can just uncross these two chords. Just replace these two chords by pair of non-crossing things. So, and that's a part, so these relations, they describe the partial order. And so let me just be a little bit more careful here. Oh, okay, same problem. Oh, yeah, okay. Okay. So that's the current relation. So let me just tell you two special cases, or actually three special cases of this current relation. So this current relation includes the possibility that this point and this point can actually be the same point. So like special cases. So for example, if these two points are coincide, then we have a pair of chords like this, then, and there is nothing that goes from this area to this area, then it covers the diagram which is obtained by replacing this pair of chords by a chord like this, and here we need to draw a loop like this. Or the other possibility, if this point coincides with this point, so if you have...
So that's the correct orientation?
Yeah, that's the correct orientation. That's kind of the special case of this relation. If you kind of pull these two points together with each other, so then this chord degenerates into counterclockwise loop.
Okay.
And similar, if you have this situation, then this guy, this chord can also degenerate into a clockwise loop. This is also a covariant relation. And even there is one more possibility. If you have a situation like this, if these two points are the same and these two points are the same, then this guy covers we can replace this pair of chords that go from like one point to the other and back. You can replace them by a pair of loops, one of them clockwise and the other is counterclockwise. And actually in this case, if you rotate the whole picture 180 degrees, well, again, there are two possibilities. So if we can do that, if there is no arrows that go from this area to this area, then you can replace them by two loops like this. Also, if there are no arrows that go from this area to this area, you can do the other way around. You can put here, kind of rotate the whole picture 180 degrees, then you have you can get here clockwise and here counterclockwise.
But anyway. Are the two conditions the same?
No. So for example, so if we have a situation like this, so for example, if you have something like this, actually there might be...
The band could be preserved.
One side could be larger than the other. But one side could have more points.
Actually, you're right. Actually, if there is an arrow that goes here, there should be crosses these two things, then there is an arrow that crosses. Yeah, actually, you can do this if the, yeah, right. So these conditions actually happen at the same time. So if there are no arrows that are going from here to here, then there is also arrow that going in the other direction. So basically, whenever you have this situation, you can replace this pair of chords by two loops like this or the other way around. Like put one of them can be clockwise and the other in counterclockwise. Actually, this situation is like in terms of the positroid. In terms of the positroid strata, so maybe I should. So that's basically in terms of the strata. So if you consider Grassmannian GR 1, 2, then the top cell corresponds to this thing, and there are two things in the boundary of this top cell. One is given by this thing, and the other is given by this thing. So that's. The geometrical picture here is a line segment with two vertices. So these two things are two vertices, and this is a one-dimensional line segment. Now, this poset has a unique maximal element that corresponds to the top cell. Okay, and the maximal element is given by decorated permutation. Okay, so let me erase this. So what's the maximal element? Like maximal element, that's the decorated permutation such that pi of I equals to I plus k modulo n. That's the unique maximal element in this poset. But there are going to be many minimal element. They're going to be actually exactly n choose k minimal elements. So can you actually figure out what are the minimal elements of this poset? So, yeah, minimal element means that we cannot go down. There is no way to go down. That basically the only possibility is that if all points are fixed points, but remember there are k of them should be clockwise, n minus k should be counterclockwise. So there are n choose k possibilities how these clockwise and counterclockwise loops can be arranged. So there are n choose k fixed points, and that's there are exactly these torus fixed points in the Grassmannian. Okay. Let me. Actually, how much time is left? Okay. So there are. I have 40 minutes. Okay, good. So then, anyway, so this is a very nice partial order. It's like Eulerian, has a lot of other nice properties. Okay, and it's very similar to the Brouwer order. Now, all these combinatorics that I described, these positroids and other things, it's very helpful for physics. So, and there was a work. There is on the scattering amplitude, formula for the scattering amplitude, found by the physicists, and later we kind of I collaborated a little bit with the physicists and on the related combinatorics, and there is a paper called Scattering Amplitudes and the Positive Grassmannian, and it's pretty dense paper, so it's like over 100 pages of very written in physical terms. I don't have time to explain all these physics here. And actually, the first hard thing about this paper is actually how to spell the name of the co-authors of this paper. There are a lot of co-authors. First is it's Nima Arkami Hamed, Jacob Burjali, Freddy Kashasa, Alexander Goncharov, me, and Yaroslav Trnka. I think his name is like really, it's just like, has a one vowel, Trnka, yeah. Well, anyway, so, check name. Yeah, anyway, so we have a very like international team. What happens is that, maybe I should say just a few general words about the scattering amplitudes, because I'm not really a physicist, so. But these scattering amplitudes can be calculated classically. They are calculated using Feynman diagrams. And this, like, very kind of nice method, but somehow, in some cases, if you do calculations, like, if you have, like, I don't know, if you can have a few elementary particles, so these scattering amplitudes describe the interactions between elementary particles. If you have a few luminary particles, then the scattering amplitudes is written in the sum over Feynman diagrams. But now if you have bigger number of particles, this sum becomes huge. So if you have sufficiently many particles, kind of this, it takes, I don't know, hundreds and hundreds of pages of very dense calculations to calculate these scattering amplitudes. But in the end, people did these calculations and they ended up with a very simple and very symmetric answer. So it was kind of a little bit like a miracle from the point of view of the Feynman diagrams. But, well, the physicists started to kind of try to understand these things, and they invented a new method to calculate these scattering amplitudes, where instead of Feynman diagrams, you need to sum over the Plevy graphs, over these trivalent graphs, the vertices of the two colors. They kind of play a role of Feynman diagrams, except that actually calculations become much more simple, and instead of 100 pages, you can do the same calculation on a half page, and they reveal more symmetries. And also, again, that's something I don't really understand, but like in Feynman diagrams, you have to introduce some kind of virtual particles, that particles don't exist. But in this picture, like everything like is on shell. So everything kind of actually lives on a on shell. So this is why the physicists call these diagrams on shell diagrams.
On shell?
On shell, because it's they're on the shell of the light cone or something like this. Anyway, so I don't want to tell you more about this because I'll probably will tell you something wrong. But anyway, so somehow from physically they kind of even make more sense than Feynman diagrams. Now, let me just tell you a little, like one little piece of this construction. So remember that in the last time I told you how to go from graphs, from a traveling graph to a positroid cell. So you can put some arrows on them, calculate the these boundary measurements, put them in a point of the Grassmannian. So we can actually, and then you get some kind of cell, some subvariety of the positive Grassmannian. So you can actually do the similar, you can, there is another way to describe this construction, well, which is basically equivalent to this one in terms of boundary measurements, but somehow it's conceptually is even more interesting. So let me try to tell you like another way to do the same, to describe the same subvariety, which kind of makes more sense from the physical point of view. Okay, so remember we have two types of particles. So we have a white particle and we have a black particle. And we think about these two particles as two little Grassmannians. So this white particle is the Grassmannian GR13. And this black particle is the Grassmannian GR23. And both of these Grassmannians are just projective spaces, projective planes. Okay. So how these kind of verticals correspond to little projective planes. Now, suppose we have a graph, Plevy graph, which is glued from these trivalent vertices. Somehow you start glue these vertices together to get a graph. And this actually can be described as gluing of these little Grassmannians into some subvarieties or into some subvariety of the large Grassmannian. Okay, so let me describe you this, how you glue this little Grassmannian into something that lives in a large Grassmannian. And so let me actually be a little bit more precise. So if you have one white particle, so on the we have parameters that live on the edges, like parameters A, B, and C. So that means that, say, these, like A, B, and C are, say, non-negative numbers. So you think about, well, you think about this A, B, and C as a play, well, this Grassmannian is a set of, sorry, lines in a three-dimensional space. So you think about this A, B, C as a line, these coordinates, projective coordinates A, B, and C, that lives in this Grassmannian. And similarly, for the black particle, you also can have three parameters, A, B, and C. Now we want to define a plane in a three-dimensional space, and this plane is a plane given by equation AX plus BY plus CZ equals to zero. That's a plane in three-dimensional space. That's a point in a Grassmannian 2-free. So somehow we have a bunch of black and white verticals. We have a bunch of lines and planes in various spaces. And now you want to put all of these together. You want to kind of start gluing some of the edges. So let me tell you how to glue them together. So let me do it by example. So let me do the very simple case where we want to glue one white vertex with one black vertex. Okay, so you have white vertex, and you have three parameters, A, B, C here. And you have one black vertex with parameters D, E, and F. And these verticals, they don't need to be of the different colors. We're allowed to glue white to white, black to black, or black to white. You can glue them in any way. Okay, so what does it mean? So let us, let's say all these A, B, C, D, E, F, let's say they're all non-negative numbers. They all are in R greater than 0, so that means that here we have a little point and a little in the positive part of little Grassmannian 1-free, and that's another point of a positive Grassmannian of 2-free. So what does it mean by that we glue them? Let's associate a formal variable with each H. Let me pick some just letter. So these capital letters X, Y, Z, T, and U. So for each H we have a letter. Again, they are not some, they don't have values, they're just like formal letters that we need. And so let me try to kind of express. So here we have a line. So it means that the line in the X, Y, U for this vertex, we have a line for in X, Y, U plane, right? So this line, the coordinates spanned by vector ABC. So it means that it's given by two linear equations. So we have this point represented by two linear equations. For example, we can write it as AX equals to BY, and also AX equals to CU. That's a line in 3D space. AX and C.
Y and B.
Yeah, CY, right, and BU. Thank you. Now, for this vertex, we have a plane. We have just single equation. We have this equation, which is EZ plus FT plus DU equals to 0. Right? So we have two equations for this point. We have one equation for this point. So we have a system of three equations into 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 variables. Now, let's take this system and let's do elimination. Let us eliminate all internal variables for internal edges. In this case, there is only one internal edge. Just eliminate U from this system. So how can we do that? It's very easy. So we can express U in terms of X. U equals to what? A over B. Remember that B is strictly positive. We can do that. X, and then we can plug this U into this equation. So we get first equation stays the same, and second equation becomes EZ plus FT plus D, instead of U we have A over B X equals to 0. So what do we get? We get a system of two equations into four variables. So we have for every boundary edge we have a variable. Now we kind of get rid of all internal variables. So, and that's a plane in a four-dimensional space. That's a point of Grassmannian 2-4. Okay, so that's kind of elimination. So somehow this gluing of edges correspond to elimination of the corresponding variables. Okay, natural question, does this construction always make sense? is it always possible to carry this elimination? So what do you think? Can we always do that for any graph or not?
What do you want to do now?
Now they were done. Like, I just explained you how to given.
So you have a large graph, which is Plavi graph, and you want to eliminate all the internal.
Yeah. So for every vertex, you write either one equation or two equations.
One or two, as you wish.
According to the color. If it's white, then it's two equations.
And then you want to eliminate all the internal edges.
Yeah, variables.
Yes, why not?
Okay, why not?
Depend on how many whites and how many blacks.
Okay, right. So,
yeah,
let me. Yeah, why not? Yeah, why? Let me do an example. So here in this case we were able to do eliminate because there was only one internal edge. It's pretty easy. But let's consider the graph. Remember, in the last lecture I had this graph. Okay. So what this graph says that we have a. So how many variables do we have? We have for every edge we have a variable. We have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So we have 7 variables. Let's say all whites. 7 variables. And for every vertex, we have 2 equations. So we have, and we have 4. Yeah, we have 8 equations. So we have a system of 7 variables. In 7 variables with 8 equations, it's kind of overdefined. So just kind of overdefined. In this case, it's kind of doesn't even have a solution. So we cannot even solve it, not only eliminate anything. So it's kind of overdefined system. So in this case, we are not able to do this elimination. And remember, that was exactly the example. Then this graph was not perfectly orientable. Because if you calculate k, for this graph, according to the rule that I gave you last time, this k was negative 1. So that means that if that would be possible to do it, we would get a point in Grassmannian negative 1, 2. But
we want legal ones.
Yeah, we get a legal, right. So that means that, and claim is that you can do this elimination procedure if and only if graph is perfectly orientable. So if it's perfectly orientable, then this works. If it's not, like here, then we kind of can run into a problem. Okay, so but that's kind of.
So then you can eliminate perfectly, precisely all the internal edges.
Yes.
Go away and
yeah, we can eliminate all internal edges, and in the end we get system of k equations, and a k is exactly given by this rule, like in terms of difference of white and black vertices. You get k equations in n variables, like in for the boundary edges. So that gives you a point in the Grassmannian. Mm-hmm. And that can be shown that basically that's equivalently to constructions in terms of the boundary measurements, but that's kind of more, I think, kind of more interesting. So somehow you think about this graph as a gluing of little Grassmannian into a big Grassmannian.
So what you do is after you glue this, after you eliminate U, you kind of glue this thing, and now you have a vertex of degree 4, and you can think about it like that. When you glue the next two, then you glue a vertex of degree 3 to this vertex of degree 4, or that's what you do.
Yeah, then quite insane. Yeah. Oh, well, in a sense, right. I mean, yeah, right. So, in a sense, you can think about this graph. You're saying so this graph has like 4 legs.
Yeah. So now we can just glue these two vertices together, and that vertex we have two equations.
Yeah, exactly. That's a so this graph represents a point in the Grassmannian 2-4. And you can attach more stuff to it. You can think about this as a kind of generalized vertex. Yeah, of degree 4, yes, exactly. Okay. Anyway, so what's interesting is construction, you don't need to, like in the construction that I told you in terms of boundary measurements, first you need to pick orientation of the edges and then look at the all directed paths. In this construction, you don't need to pick orientation of the edges. It's kind of more invariant. Okay, so the physical formula, again, I may say something
what's
wrong, but okay, so interpretation is, physicists wrote some integral, some integral over some of some form over the Grassmannian, and now in order to solve the system, so you have to look at the singularities of this form. You calculate residues of this form. and somehow the way how you start calculating residues, in the end, that corresponds to, is represented by the graphs. So the graphs represent a way to calculate an integral by doing in terms of singular.
So it's not a physical. My physics friends explained to me that the final diagrams are just a very clever way of organizing your calculation. That they do not necessarily represent any.
Yeah, in a sense, it's the same here. And again, I'm not a physicist. I don't take my words for for the truth. But the way I understand it, it's also a way to organize your calculation of this integral.
An even more sophisticated
way of doing it. Well, in a sense, which is
more
even
efficient,
more efficient way to carry the same calculations. So kind of organize the same thing into different classes. And actually, it's not unique. So there are several ways to calculate the same amplitude. So you can write the same amplitude in terms of one sum of a graph, but you can also write it in terms of another sum of the graphs. Mm-hmm. So somehow, for every graph like this, in the end, will be some rational expression.
So you can try and go back. So does this equivalence have any interesting mathematical implications?
Yeah, it has interesting mathematical implications, because actually there are some, for the graphs like this, there are some rational functions. These rational functions actually depend not on the graph itself, but on the corresponding cell in the Grassmannian. So they don't change when you do these square moves. But also there are more relations. There are other relations which are somehow you can kind of now combine different graphs together. There will be some relations between them. And that's, I think, very interesting to study this relationship mathematically. And let me mention, in the remaining time, let me mention three directions for the generalization of the story that I told you. So one direction is, again, that's is motivated by physics and also mathematically. So actually, as you see, this construction doesn't use the planarity at all. It makes perfect sense if graph is non-planar, just any abstract graph. The edges can intersect, and actually that makes us from physical point of view that makes sense for any graph. So somehow planar graphs gives you the first approximation, like the tree level amplitude. So somehow the first approximation, but actually it's very interesting to extend all these combinatorics and all things that we did to arbitrary graphs. And somehow for planar graphs we kind of understand combinatorics. Very interesting, very non-trivial combinatorics, and we kind of understand it pretty well. We have these square moves, we have decorated permutations, and so on. Have a lot of tools to work with planar graphs, but for non-planar graphs, the story is widely open. So we know that these moves are no longer enough. I mean, they still can do the same moves, but they don't give the whole all equivalences. Decorated permutations is also not enough. It's not the complete invariant, so there will be some other relationship between non-planar graphs. And it's an open question to understand this structure in general. So,
but you think there is an interesting structure?
Yeah, there is for any non-planar graphs, there is some form, some rational expression, some form, and it's interesting to understand this mathematically.
It's related to this positive...
Well, it's no longer related to, positive Grassmannian is a kind of, positivity is related to planarity, in a sense. So this positivity is a planar phenomenon. And that's one of the reasons, why it works so well. So somehow planarity and positivity come together. So if you work with arbitrary graphs, it's no longer the positive part of the Grassmannian, but still we have some sub-variety in a Grassmannian. There's still some way to get some rational expression for each graph, and it's interesting to understand this expressions mathematically. So there is some interesting mathematical structure. So what is...
But geometrically, what replaces the Grassmannian?
Well, it's still the Grassmannian.
It's still the Grassmannian.
But it's no... Yeah, but it's no longer if the graph is no longer planar, this... What we get in then, it's no longer belongs to the positive part of the Grassmannian. So somehow positivity is related to planarity, but then you allow crossing edges, then that's some sub-variety in the Grassmannian, and want to kind of understand these sub-varieties better and extend all these combinatorics decorated permutations, these moves and so on to this more general case, and where it's kind of very widely open. So what is known is the case k equals to 2. So non-planar story, if k equals to 2, that's already very interesting and very non-trivial, even k equals 2. So remember, positive Grassmannian for k equals 2 is kind of relatively simple. But here, in the non-planar case, it's already very interesting, very non-trivial, but it looks like so this kind of part is understood, and there was a recent paper, well, mostly written by physicists. They put me as a co-author because I kind of helped a little bit to understand the combinatorics, but they wrote a physical paper. Actually, probably we should make a mathematical paper, because claims which are written in this paper are physical claims. Kind of probably we
so
need.
So there are claims about solving such equations of the non-planar graphs.
Yes, right. So for the non-planar graphs, when k equals to 2,
you can answer.
There is a nice description of these graphs. For every graph, there is some rational form associated with this graph, and there are some relations between them. And it looks like, so, for physicists, that's theorem. I think mathematically, we should make them into mathematical theorems. But kind of, there is interesting.
There is at least the mathematical
theorem.
There are statements. There are statements. Okay, and some of them proved. Well, anyway, so there is an interesting structure. Like for k equals 2, it's kind of doable, and it's nice and interesting. Beyond k equals to 2, for k equals to 3, it's already widely open. So how do kind of non-planar structure, how this non-planar structure looks for k equals to 3, for example, it's very interesting and open problem. So let me mention, in the remaining time, I want to mention two other generalization of this story. Like, one direction is to generalize to non-planar graphs. There is another generalization. So one of the generalizations is the paper that we almost written with Miriam Farber. It's about, so here we study the positive Grassmannian. So we study all possible arrangements of minors. So we require that some minors are equal to 0. Some are strictly greater than 0. And we looked at all possible possibilities for that. That's exactly these cells. What we did with Miriam, we kind of, in a sense, it's a kind of higher order question. So instead of looking at zeros, you look at when two things are equal to each other. Like then, right? So if you look at, first you look at zeros of some function, then you look at kind of critical points of the functions. Then, and there are the structure that appear there is also related to all these kind of combinatorics, and it's very nice and beautiful. The other extension is a paper that we are writing with Thomas Lamb. It's called the polypositroid theorem. Polypositroids. So,
what it is about?
Oh. Okay. So it is, well, about, well, there are many things, but one thing that we do there is about polymatroid extension of this theory. Because here we talk about matroids. So what are matroids? If you think about them in terms of bases, so bases correspond to like some subsets. So these the 0, 1 vectors, that's exactly vertices of the matroid polydops. Now, if you look at the multisets correspond to integer vectors. They're no longer 0, 1 vectors, but just any integer vectors. And so somehow you can drop the condition that all vertices of these polydops are 0, 1 vectors, but leave all other conditions, and everything this generalizes very nicely. Okay, so maybe I should try to say a couple of words about each of these projects.
There's also this notion of amplitude.
That's another interesting generalization. So maybe that's amplitudahedron. That's, well, physicists called it a polytope, but it's a polytope. Well, basically for them, the positive Grassmannian is also a polytope.
So it's a
It's a CW complex, and probably conjecture it's that it's regular. So let me tell you, like, maybe a couple of words about the amplitahedron. Well, yeah, I don't know. There are like three themes, and I have 10 minutes.
15 minutes.
Oh, 15. Five. Okay, 5 minutes for each. Yeah. Okay, so.
Miriam told us
okay.
About the work, but
okay, so you
only,
already heard Miriam.
Only the two of us, or few of us.
Yeah. Okay,
yeah,
so.
No,
okay, but so
five,
let.
5 minutes for each topic.
Okay, so let me talk about amplitahedron. So. The story is the following. So if you start with a simplex, so as we saw, like this positive Grassmannian, 1n, it's basically a simplex, n minus one dimensional simplex. Now, if you look at the projection of this simplex, you can get any polytope as the projection of this simplex. Well, actually, for physicists, you take not any projection, but projection given by a positive, totally positive matrix. That means that if you project a simplex by a totally positive matrix, you don't get any polytope, but you get a cyclic polytope. So somehow you take the matrix again from n-dimensional from R n to R m. Given by m by n matrix, say all minors are positive, then the result is going to be cyclic polytope. Okay? So, for example, if you projected simplex into two-dimensional space, you get like n gone. In three-dimensional, you get this like moment curve, you put n points on the moment curve, so you get, and the structure of the cyclic polytopes is well understood. So how the faces look like. Now it turns out that from physical point of view, it's very natural to do the same thing not only for the simplex but for any positive Grassmannian. So you take this positive Grassmannian GRKN, which is some CW complex, and project it by some m by n matrix into subset of the positive Grassmannian GRKM. Yeah. Maybe I should. Like, yeah.
So this is the analog of the polytope, or is the analog of the cyclic polytope?
It's going to be analog of cyclic polytope. So if you like the positive, so if you like the positive Grassmannian is a generalization of this simplex.
Right, but this matrix should be positive. Or
yeah, this is all. The matrix that you use to project is a totally positive.
So it's a map on the level of Grassmannian.
So this will give you a subset.
Yeah, so there is a map from Grassmannian GR KN to GR KM where
by composition.
So it's a K dimensional planes in N dimensional space, then you take a projection from this N dimensional space to M dimensional set that's given by positive matrix, and you get subset here that also looks like a physicist called it a polytope, but it's not a convex polytope, but it's a complex. It also has some kind of cells of various dimensions, and really, in the physical calculations of this integral, really, this polytope plays a role.
So this is more general than the positive.
This is a generalization of the positive. So the positive Grassmannian is already a very non-trivial thing. It's even more general.
And this, you can also generalize any polytope by dropping this positive total.
Yeah, right, and that's kind of idea of Thomas Lem. He said that maybe we don't even can drop this condition, so you can think about any polytope as the projection of a simplex. Now you can try to do the same kind of
images
for take any projection of the positive Grassmannian, you can get any kind of, can get the theory of Grassmannian polytopes. And the theory is to develop, problem is to develop this theory, understand the structure of the...
But for the positive case, this is the...
Yeah, for the from physical point of view, this positive projection plays a special important role, because this formula for the amplitudes is actually literally written as a volume, again, volume of this amplitudohedron.
And this cell structure for this guy, so for the positive Grassmannian, you had a complete combinatorial equation.
Yeah.
Do you have also for
no.
these guys?
No.
Because cyclic polytope, we also have...
Yeah, that's like there are two special cases, two kind of opposite cases, two extreme cases, cyclic polytope and positive Grassmannian, and there is something in between, generalization of both.
K equal 2?
Yeah, I think, yeah. In some cases, I think it's understood for k equal to...
But you think there is hope to understand?
Yeah. That's definitely, I think, something a very, very important problem is to understand and generalize all these combinatorics, these decorated permutations, and so on. Understand this combinatorial structure of this amplitudohedron. How the projection of these things look like. So that's kind of, interesting problem. And again, it's, I think, very important from physical point of view. So that's this amplitudohedron story.
Take it only for something which is formal?
Yeah. So they're like, for them, it's a very, again, they are, I especially interested in the case that m equals 2 4, because that's what appears in
we
physics. But from a mathematical point of view, that's no reason to restrict. And but again, even for k equals 2 4, it's already something very.
What's
m equals 2 4. Somehow
is
that's.
No.
Okay, so if Nima, so maybe next time, then will Nima come here? You can ask him why 4 is important.
Some theory which works very nice.
Yeah, so it's physical
it
theory.
Well, they live.
Okay, yeah, but again, right? Mathematically, I think that's very, very, very interesting mathematical problem is to understand the projection of all these structures that I'm talking about. Especially with respect to these totally positive projections, because there seems to be kind of, because cyclic polytopes has a kind of nicer structure than arbitrary polytopes, but again, there might be even some generalization to all projections. So extend these combinatorics. So the other direction is to kind of extend these combinatorics to non-planar graphs. And let me use 5 minutes to talk about, should I talk about polypositroids? Yeah, maybe I should just say a couple of words about polypositroids. Because the story there is very, very nice. Remember that positroid polytopes. Which is, I think I mentioned it, maybe in the first or second lecture, you can think about this class of polytopes as the intersection of matroid polytopes. That are decomposed into alcoves. So they're, which are also at the same time, alcove polytopes. So, and what matroid polytopes? Polytopes where we have special directions of the edges. So all edges are directed as EI minus EJ. So for example, so they allow only these three directions, like for n equals to 3, it's E1 minus E2, this is E2 minus E3, this is E1 minus E3. So you look at polytopes, the third special direction of the edges. And alcove polytopes are also polytopes with very special directions of the facets, of the normals to facets. So here, alcove polytopes, all inequalities have the form xi plus xi plus 1 plus the dot plus xj is less than or equal to a. So you take any cyclic interval, add coordinates in the cyclic interval, and bound them. So, or in terms of, or you can write, or you can write them as EI minus EJ is less than or equal to A, where Ys are initial sums of Xs. Okay. But for matroid polytops, all vortices are 0-1 vectors. They correspond to subsets. Now, in this polymatroid theory, you just drop this condition. You just look at all polytops with given directions of normals. So what are they? Like, for example, for n equals to 3, these polytops, I don't know, they can be like hexagons, but like something like this. So that's, if you like, polymatroid polytop. So you only allow these three directions. I also call them generalized permutahedra because, for example, a permutahedron is a polytop of this class. Also, there's a sahedron. And there is a nice theory of this generalized permutahedron or polymatroid polytops. Okay, now what are the alcove polytops? So remember, so we have these kind of subdivisions into alcoves. So we have this, and you look at any polytop, which is a union of some set of alcoves. So something like this. And for dimension 2, they're also kind of, in general, like hexagons. So actually, they look like, for n equals 2, for dimension 2, this class of polytops is exactly the same as this class of polytops. But it's a little bit misleading. Actually, this, like for higher dimensions, then you get two different classes of polytops. So somehow these hexagons generalize into higher dimensions into two different ways. But they do have an interesting intersection. And that's exactly this polymatroid polytops, they kind of polypositroid polytops, they correspond to polymatroids. Intersection of this class of polytops with this class of polytops, and all combinatorics that I talk about, and also and it's also related to total positivity in some general sense, can be extended to these polytops. And maybe I should just tell you like one little piece of this thing is what is the analog of decorated permutation in this more general setting. So in a more general setting, instead of decorated permutations, you need to look at what we call balanced graphs. So you have, again, vertices. So how to generalize diagrams? Like I showed you before, you arrange vertices 1 up to n on a circle. And now you connect them by directed edges. But now you allow several edges to go out of each vertex. So before there was exactly one edge entering vertex and one edge leaving. Now we can have several edges. And the only condition is that in degree equals to out degree. So for example, we can have something like this.
And you can have loops.
We can have loops, but actually we can get rid of these loops because actually loops don't play a big role here. Loops basically correspond to affine translations of the polytop. This 0 and cos 0, they combinatorial. If you just remove them, the polytops will stay the same. You just kind of translate it by vectors, like, but up to affine translations, you can kind of get rid of all these loops. But you get a polytop where in degree of each vertex equals to the out degree. Okay, cannot make it. Something is wrong here. Yeah, that's why. Anyway, so there should be some way to. Anyway, okay, so in this polypositroid theory, instead of these permutation diagrams, we need to, one theorem, like we have many results, but one result is that these polypositroid polytops, which are intersection of these two classes, so exactly generalized polymatroid polytops, which kind of decompose into alcoves, they're in bijection of these graphs. So maybe I should say, logically speaking, this theorem that I just told you doesn't make any sense. I mean, totally trivial, because this is an infinite set, and this is an infinite set, and two infinite sets are countable in bijection with each other. But there is like a concrete construction, how to construct a polytop like this from the graph like this. There is explicit bijection. And just, I should say, all combinatorics extend very nicely, and proofs become even simpler if you think about them from the polytopal point of view.
This includes also the proof for the classical positive
graph. Yeah, right. And instead of positive grasp Banion, we have to think about, okay, some quotient of the positive Grassmannian modulo some parabolic subgroup. But anyway, so there is some generalization of the whole story in this setting, and there are some... Okay, but I don't really have time to do it, describe it in more details, and maybe I should use... I'm already run out of time.
Okay,
let me use maybe 5 more minutes to talk about our project with Miriam. Because we really hope to finish it very soon. It should appear on the archive, hopefully soon. So what we do there, we study all equalities, all possible equalities between the minors. So you have a... and before we started to work with Miriam, she actually wrote 2 nice papers where, kind of from an extremal combinatorial paper, where... Well, with several co-authors. So there she looked at all maximal possible number of equal minors in a totally positive matrix. And there is some bounds on these numbers. So, but what we started to look with Miriam, we try to kind of understand the structure of equalities between the minors more kind of combinatorially. We just wanted to understand not just the number of possible equal minors, but exactly the structure. And we have a very good understanding of the smallest equal minor and of the largest equal minor. So let me talk a little bit about the smallest equal minor. So in other words, we call it an arrangement of equal minors. So minors here are just Plucker coordinates. So that's some subset of smallest. That's a subset in the N choose K, such that there exists matrix K by N matrix A, such that the maximal minor of this matrix are all equal for I in this subset, and we can rescale it, make all of them 1 or equal to 1 if I is in S, and they're strictly greater than 1 if I is not in S. That's an arrangement of smallest minor. And question, how do we describe these arrangements? And what we proved is the following. So for any Plevy graph for the top cell, so remember that we have a top cell in the Grassmannian, and there are several Plevy graphs for this top cell, and all of them are obtained from each other by the moves. So for any Plevy graphs, there is a such arrangement of equal minors. So let me show how to do it. So for example, for the Grassmannian, that's exactly Grassmannian 2-4. So there are 2 Plevy graphs for the top cell. So this one, 3-4, and the other, which is obtained by the square move. So we can now label the regions of this graph by subsets as follows. So basically, we need to do the same thing as we use for the decorated permutation. So you start at 1, for example, and use these rules of the road. If it's white, turn left. If it's black, turn right. So you get left, right, left. And you put, and you end up at 3. So you're going to put 3 everywhere to the right of this path. Okay, then you start at 2, you go you add up 3, you put 3 here, 4 here.
No, then, 2.
No, you end up, if you start at 2, so you put the target. And here you go right, left, right, so you end up at 1, so you put 1, 1, and something is wrong here.
No, it's not right.
Yeah, sorry, let me start again. That's very confusing. So it goes, so what is left? So you get left, right, left.
Yes.
And you put 3 on the right. 3, 3, 3. Then you start here. You go, oh, okay. You go right, left, right.
Yes.
So then you put 4
places.
Here and here.
Yeah.
So you go here, left, right, left. You end in one, you get one. Put 1, 1, 1. And finally, you go this way, you put 2 here. Okay, so the end result is that in any region, you have some subset. And all of them are going to be elements, will have k elements. And this is an arrangement of, we proved that this is an arrangement of smallest minors. And we have a conjecture that any maximal by size arrangement of smallest minors actually has this form. And for a while we also thought that there are just any maximal by containment arrangement of smallest minor has this form, but then we tried to prove it for a while, but then Miriam found a counterexample. It was a very challenging computational problem to find this counterexample. It was really, yeah, anyway, so it's not true that any, so this seems to be maximal by size, but not maximal by containment. So there are, we have some examples of these maximal by containment arrangements, but there are definitely a lot of structures, but we still don't have a complete understanding. They should probably correspond to some more generalized objects and Plebe graphs. And on the other hand, we can talk about, we have a very good understanding of arrangements of largest minors. So the minors which are equal to each other and greater than everything else. So for this case, we have complete understanding. Here we have complete proofs. And these arrangements are exactly in bijection stiff alcoves in the alcove subdivision of the hypersimplex. Because each alcove, well, it has a sum given by some subset of vertices of the hypersimplex. So these vertices correspond to some subsets. And we prove that these are exactly arrangements of largest minors. Okay, so that's, and there are a lot of other results and conjectures in this paper. And okay, and I think I can finish here.
Thank you very much. And also a little present from us.
Oh,
thank you.
Thank you.